God bless
my
you.
Apostle, sir. God bless you, sir. It's my pleasure to hear your voice.
Thank you for having me, man of God.
Thank you, sir. We are on live right now on Facebook, YouTube, and our Shepherd's Touch TV. We are in a most unique and serious season in the history of humanity. Never has it been said that one day everybody will be confined to his bedroom, not just for 5 days, not for 3 weeks, but for over a month now, because of one virus that has permeated not just one nation, but all over the world. So I don't know what is God saying to you concerning this time and season in which we live in, especially the coronavirus and its effect and impact in our generation and time.
All right, thank you, Dr. Talina. Let me start by correcting something. The church and those who are indoors, and let's say there have not been services in churches for a while, now we are not indoors because of coronavirus. We are indoors because of the government's order. That's coronavirus right. Is too small to keep us out of the pulpit or to keep us indoors. We have orders from the government to say stay indoors. And that is why recently I threw a challenge that the government should dare the church and say, gather. If we give you 2 weeks and this whole thing is not handled, then we'll stop your gathering. There was nothing like that. Right. So I need to establish that fact that we are not indoors because of a virus. We are indoors because of an order, which the Bible in Romans 13 verse 1 tells us that let all power be subject to the higher power. So we have to obey authority. That's one. Number two, you know, in Isaiah chapter 2 verse 2, he says, in the last day, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains. Actually should be the finest hour for the church, because this is the confrontation that has come to chaos. Coronavirus is not bigger than cancer. We never stayed out of church because of cancer. Never. Coronavirus is not bigger than HIV. We never stayed out of church because of HIV. But this one is an affliction that is backed up with a political power and a satanic agenda. The political power is to cripple certain forces that will stop the agenda of the one world government. So what we are seeing right now is not just a virus. It's something that has the backing of the powers that be, has the backing of a certain individuals who wants to put everybody on. And that is why a few of us are rebellious to say it will not stand. So the virus is beyond just a flu or a virus. It has political undertone. It has financial backing, because we can see how it came about. This is something that did not come as an epidemic, as it were. It came as a pandemic. It came as an onslaught, a machination of something that came about in Wuhan, China. So that is exactly what we are up against. Not one mere flu or one mere viral infection. It has a political backing, and that is why it has been so strong on the face of the earth.
Apostle, I attempt to believe you. If not, look at the sitting of yesterday by the members of House of Representatives.
Exactly.
They're already passing a bill on vaccine. Everybody must be injected. And it has gone first, second reading within the shortest time.
The speed with which it has crossed second reading, no bill has gotten such ascension.
I'm telling you.
Even
before the vaccine will come out, sir.
Vaccine is not out. So why going about to implement compulsory vaccination? If you say there is no vaccine, why are you about passing a law that we implement compulsory vaccination for a vaccine that has not yet been discovered? So you see that this whole thing, people are here to understand that sickness is nothing. Virus, we have seen in our service, and I'm sure you may have been seeing that in your live service, people being healed of the virus.
Yes.
So it is nothing. It is too small, but it's an agenda. There is an agenda. There is an agenda to see that people are brought on their knees. The church is ridiculed. They want to ridicule the church, ridicule preachers, and that is why some of us are raising up our head to say this will not stand, because we understand the undertone of the virus.
That's true. Apostle, for we believer, I declare this month our month of the unfinished work of Christ. All over the place, people have been preaching on the finished work of Christ, the operations of grace. But in my study, I have discovered that there are the unfinished work of Christ. And some of them are like prayer is the unfinished work of Christ. Giving is the unfinished work of Christ. I know Christ died for us. He finished the work. He declared it's finished. But we can't stop giving. We can't stop praying. Evangelism is also the unfinished work of Christ. Love is also the unfinished work of Christ. Even though Christ has finished the work. If you don't love your brother as yourself, think, listen, but yes, sir. What are we going to say about this?
Jesus Christ only said it is finished to sin. Sin. When he said it is finished, he was saying the price of sin is paid once and for all. No more blood of goats, no more blood of bulls, no more blood of animals. I have paid the price. But the same Jesus in John 14, 12 said, the work that I do, shall you do also. And greater works shall you do. So Christ is not going to do crusades to evangelize the world. Christ is not going to come and sponsor missionaries. Christ is not going to come and help you love your wife. You need to develop the virtue of love. Christ is not going to come and make you submissive for your husband. So the work is not finished. You see, many of us, the problem we have is that we have so bastardized the message of grace. And like I've always said, the message of grace is not the problem, but the preachers of grace. Now, they've made it appear that grace is now spiritual and religious recklessness. No need to wake up to pray at night. Christ has done that for you. No need to give. Christ has done that for you. No need to give sacrificially because the sacrifice has been paid once and for all. Christ has done that for you. The Lord Jesus said concerning fasting, when the bridegroom is taken away, then shall they fast. Because when he was around physically, they were not fasting. And people were angry. Why are your disciples eating? He said, because I am here physically with them. When I am taken away, they will not need to, they will then begin to fast. So we have a huge assignment, massive assignment, go into the world and preach the gospel. If the work was finished, it would send us to go out. So we discover we have a generation of people who are spiritually lazy and they have to hide under a revelation and a discovery to endorse their laxity and their lethargy. So we are in a generation of people who cannot confront and take the battle to the gates of the enemy. So they hide under the guise, you know, spreading the message of grace and saying that the work is finished.
That's true. And Apostle, sir, on one of the unfinished work of Christ is prayer. Prayer to me is like an expression of divinity through your humanity to take control of your physical activity. Prayer is a spirit praying through mortality. That is why when you pray, sometimes it is good for us to pray sincerely and in earnestness. Because prayer enables us to subdue the flesh so that the will of God can be perfected. Sir, what have you got to say about prayer and this time in which we live in? What is the importance of prayer in this kind of confinement, in these days of lawlessness? People don't fear God anymore. Yes, sir.
Prayer. Let me first of all establish something, that there are different dimensions to prayer. We are not just called to prayer because there's a pandemic out there. First of all, it has to be from the platform of our love for God. Our love for God is what helps us to maintain a healthy prayer life. Now, even when things are well, we still pray. It has to be our love for God. Prayer is not a gift. It's a discipline. There's nobody who has the gift of prayer. That is why it's in Acts chapter 6, verse 4, that we will give ourselves to the ministry of the word and prayer. You give yourself. It's a discipline. And in Matthew 21, 13.
Jesus, the importance.
Yes, in Matthew 21, 13, Jesus said, my father's house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers. So when prayer is absent, robbery is empowered. Destiny robbery, marital robbery, financial robbery. When prayer is handicapped, when prayer is bankrupt, robbery is buoyant. So we discover that a lot of people today, look at what he said. He said in Psalm 55 from verse 16 and 17, he said, but as for me, I will call upon God. Evening and morning will I pray. I will cry aloud. He shall hear my voice. The only weapon to turn the battle to the gates of the enemy is prayer. And that is why, if you see the ministry of Jesus, the only thing the disciple asked him to teach them was prayer. Luke 11, verse 1. He said, teach us how to pray. John taught his disciples. And Jesus said, when you pray, say. He never said, write. Prayer is not a lecture. It's an activity. When you pray, say. He said, when you pray, say. So the best way to learn prayer is to start praying prayer.
That's true.
In Acts chapter 12.
You start praying prayer. I love that.
Acts chapter 12. The Bible says that Satan stretched his hand to vex, Herod stretched his hand to vex certain of the church. And prayers were made. Prayers were not prayed. They were made. People began to manufacture prayer. People became prayer machines, prayer producers. Mm. The prayer is the strength of the believer. In Psalm 4:1, he said, hear me when I call, O God, my righteousness. Prayer is the strength of the believer. In Psalm 18, if you read verse 3, the Bible says, I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. So any one of us, in Psalm 62, Psalm 65, verse 2, rather, he said, thou that hearest prayer unto thee shall all flesh come. There is a portion of the scripture that I love so much. It's Isaiah 65, verse 24. He said, before they call, I will answer. While they are speaking, I will hear. Before they call, see. I will answer A. While they are speaking, S, I will hear H. That is cash. That's cash.
That's right.
Before they call, C, answer A, S, speaking, H. Yeah, so that's Operation Cash. God wants
Operation Cash.
If you want to cash out in the spirit, then you must understand the ministry of prayer. That was the only thing that took Jesus out of the midst of the disciples. In Luke 6, verse 12, the Bible says he left them and he prayed all night. So prayer should be the lifestyle of a believer, whether things are good, whether things are bad. So what I said, there's a different dimension to prayer. This time, what we need, the dimension of prayer, we need to initiate is intercessory prayers.
Intercessory prayer. You're right, sir.
Intercessory prayers at this time. That's what we
need. That's true. Yes, Apostle, sir. In Luke 18:1, he said, men always ought to pray and not to faint. So to me, it looks like prayer is a spiritual prescription for strength. Prayer also is remedy for human situations. So not to pray is to be vulnerable to the powers and the operations of the time. Sir, in this time, I think the velocity of prayer for the church need to be strong. Every individual need to be strong because the power of darkness is on invasion.
Yes.
You want to look at the internet, for example, the internet, the way people in the name of God speaks, they have no respect for the altar, they have no respect for the things of God. They speak, so there's this spirit of lasciviousness, lawlessness, that is permeating our generation. And I wonder if it is this same generation that are going to hand over the baton to the next generation in power and glory. So I feel that the enemy wants to ridicule the church, and prayer is a serious requirement. What do you think, sir? Especially being a spiritual prescription for strength. Yes.
Let me start on the platform that you already raised up. The Bible says men ought to pray. It didn't say people. It said men. Men.
That's right.
Men, those that pray are men. It's for the mature. He didn't just say people ought to pray. He said men ought to pray. Meaning once, what the true test for maturity is prayer. At this time, the prayer that will give a man strength is the prayer of fellowship. The prayer that helps you to stand out. If you read 2 Corinthians 13, 14, he said, now the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit. And that is why I tell people all the time that we are in the era of the Holy Spirit. That will enhance your fellowship with the Holy Spirit. That is where draw strength from. It is from communion you draw strength from. When you get into communion this end time, you begin to draw strength. Because like you said, in as much as we know, many pastors have not really helped issues. A lot of nonsense have happened that has given people leverage to tongue lash the church. But that does not give anyone right. And you know, I've always said this before. I was in a religion before I became a Christian. And the religion I was in, we saw many pedophiles. We saw many of the so-called leaders in their 70s and 80s who are messing up little children that are not even up to teenagers. But nobody from that religion ever brings it out.
That's true.
But it gives you the reference. It's not right, it is wrong, it's condemnable, it's a bad act, but they have a mentality of this thing, we leave it to our God to judge who this person is. But this generation
can go as far that as if a pastor makes an utterance, not even an act of sin, just an utterance that they are not comfortable with, it is fellow so-called Christians that will debate it. That is to let you create the altar of prayer. Because if you are a man who maintains your altar of prayer, one of the things that the Spirit of God will do is to bridle your tongue.
If you are a person who maintains an altar of prayer, one of the things is to keep your character in check. So every believer wants to draw strength this end time must operate one dimension of prayer, and that is communion with the Holy Spirit. Begin to desire to know the Holy Spirit. With the Holy Spirit. And that is exactly what every one of us need to start pursuing now.
That's true. You know, Apostle, sir. Hello.
I can hear you.
Apostle, you know, in Hebrew chapter 7, verse 5, Bible says, in the days of his flesh,
yes,
the offer of prayer. The day God wore flesh, he prayed.
Mm-hmm.
The day spirit wore flesh, spirit began to pray. The Bible said when they came to their own company, they lifted up their voice and prayed, sir. It was not a casual prayer. And the Bible said, and the place where they prayed, that is was in shaking. The book of Acts chapter 6, was shaking.
Was shaking.
The prayer that can shake a building can shake a city.
Mm-hmm.
The prayer that can shake a building can shake coronavirus out of the life of anybody. So there is power in prayer. Sir, I want you again to emphasize the potency of prayer. And then from there, we will enter another dimension of praying and speaking into the life of God's people, sir.
Like I said, the only prescription that works is prayer. Anything prayer can do, God can do.
That's right.
And what prayer cannot do, more prayers will do it. What prayer cannot do, more prayers will do it.
Prayers can we do, we'll
do it.
Did you hear that?
If you have prayed and nothing has happened, you have not prayed enough.
You have not prayed
Elijah was praying in 1 Kings 18. He told the servant, go and check. The servant went to check. He said, I see nothing. He continued. Until you see something, you have not prayed enough. So prayer is that prescription that works anytime. You see, the church of God, anytime they are faced with a persecution and a tribulation, such as we are in now, they gathered themselves and they prayed. And anytime they gave themselves a prayer, they always launched into a new level. Look at what he said about Elijah in James chapter 5, from verse 16 to 17 and 18. He said Elijah was a man of like passion, meaning Elijah had capacity to be tired. He had capacity to be weak. He had capacity to be deflated. He had capacity to be discouraged. But he prayed. What stood him out was that he prayed. I like the living word. The living word said he prayed prayer. That
today's Roman Bible
said
that apostle.
You have not heard anything. Hold on. That today's Roman Bible said he prayed till prayer could testify that he prayed.
Homer Bible.
Somebody prayed until prayer
testified that he prayed.
Somebody prayed and prayer said you have prayed. So you discover that a lot of people have not prayed enough. Because when you have prayed enough, prayer will tell you that you have prayed. The prayer you are praying and you are looking at
the whole of your capillaries will respond. Yes.
Jesus prayed prayer and the veins, his bodily expression gave way. The Bible says that
it was broken.
Broken because there were thick drops of sweat coming with blood. So the prayer, this prayer, there are three things that determine this kind of prayer. Number one, it is time-consuming. It is time-consuming. True prayer, prevailing prayer is time-consuming. Number two, it is passionate. You can't be praying and be receiving calls. You can't be praying and be sending text message. You can't be praying and you remember you still have a wristwatch on your wrist. It is time consuming. It is passionate. And number three, it is backed up with fasting. These are the requirements for prevailing prayer. A prayer that means
the intensity of the spirit is what allows physical verbalization.
Yes. Yes. That's what this expression, if you must penetrate into the realms of the spirits, then you must go as a spirit. You can never enter spirit world as a mortal man. You enter as a spirit. And when we begin to pray, we are doing business with spirits. We are doing business with deep waters.
Because a spirit came out in their prayer and shook a building.
Yes.
Prayer. Spirit came out of their prayer and shook a building. It's a serious matter.
That building, the vibration that building had was spirit at work. There was a clash of spirit. So it must be passionate, it must be time consuming, and it must be backed up with fasting. You see, when you fast, not if you fast, it's not an advice, it's a command. When you fast, it's an order. When you fast,
you fast.
So your intensity of passion, of time, and of fasting is what gives prevalence and potency to our prayers. So that's exactly what we need to apply to get uncommon, incontestable results.
Apostle, sir, what? Yes. Apostle, sir.
Yes, sir.
What is your advice in this day of serious disrespect for the altar, gross darkness against the church, total rebellion and lawlessness against the church? The value of the church is being disrespected. What should the pastors and what should believers do in this last day? It appears as if believers are under wicked mockery, wicked attack. For example, you said we are going to pray for people with coronavirus. I have already have a statistics of over 66 people that have been healed of coronavirus. And one rebellious man is asking for $1,000 as if he does not know that you are a multimillionaire in dollars. So there's this total disrespect. What kind of operation is required for believers and pastors to operate in this last day? Yes, sir.
I will say four things. Number one, as pastors, we need to be character sound. Because some pastors, some of us, our character is questionable and has now given the platform for mockery. We need to become very careful in our operations, in our dealings, in our attitude, in our lifestyle. And because we can go and say, in the days of our fathers, it wasn't so. In the days of our fathers, the crave for money wasn't like this. In the days of our fathers, the crave for material food was not like this. In the days of our fathers, the character, the attitude, our fathers were spiritual. Our fathers were conscious of God. So they didn't get much mockery. That's number one. We must make sure that we start telling God, build us up so that we don't become a mockery. The Bible even says it. It says, so that the gospel be not mocked for your sake. So that's very important. Number two, we need to understand the spirit of the last days is the spirit of rebellion. As we draw close to the end of age, Satan wants to see that young people are ruined. So he exposes them to gadgets. Don't forget, we are in a technological age. And one of the things technology sponsors, if you are not careful, is rebellion. It's technology sponsors rebellion. It makes people think that there is nothing special to anything. Everything can be sorted out in Google. Everything is technologically improvised. Number three, which I must say, there are certain agents who have made it a point of duty to see that they depopulate the church. Like the one you mentioned just now, when the Lord told me, he said, this is an insult to the body of Christ. Tell them, if they are serious with the numbers they are given, let them allow pastors to go and pray. The young man or the whoever...
Because we can't see that number. If they are serious, show us the number and show us the people.
Yes. The young man or the useless man who came up to say to he represents, according to him, the alleged council of witches. And normally, I will not reply critics, but somebody who is a spokesman for witches cannot speak to me and I'll keep quiet. And that is why, do you know, when I finish this, our viewers can go and check it. When I finish this, when we finish this recording, they can go and check it. From Tuesday, we declared war against this virus, began to pray. My pastor in Italy called me that yesterday, they had over 4,000 people that tested negative. You can check it online. The one in Spain called me and said over 6,000. Now, it has not happened for the past 4 months. So it could not have called this a coincidence. For 4 months it has not happened. It happened this week. That if the pastors, we all raise up our voice against this nonsense, the monster would have long taken off. We have now accepted it. We have now relaxed with it. Then number four, there are some people that God wants to use as scapegoats. That is why it's allowing them to run their mouths. He wants to give judgment on them. He wants to use them as scapegoat. Because don't forget, in the time of the church, the early church, there were people that raised up their voices against the church. One was Herod. He began to claim the place of God. And God took him out. Those who are speaking against the church have to be careful. And also, our disunity is also the platform for this mockery on the church. God nominated us, but we denominated ourselves. Joshua Tadina speaks because he's not my pastor, I attack him. Suleiman speaks because he's not my pastor, I attack him. Forgetting that once a man of God speaks, and he's not speaking of himself, he speaks scripture, he speaks what we can prove in scripture, what we can see in scripture, he has become our voice. We will line up with him and identify with him. On the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost came upon all of them. But Peter spoke. Somebody has to speak. When Peter spoke, others did not counter him. They were listening.
They didn't counter.
And that is what the church must do. We must have a voice. It doesn't matter who speaks. We speak with him. We stand with him. And if he has done wrong, we defend him publicly. Then we draw him indoors and correct him and discipline him and rebuke him where he needs to be rebuked.
That's right. That's right.
That's exactly what it is.
That's true. My apostle, sir, we are internally grateful. We are in this last day, and I want you to take your time to also pray for all our viewers right now. They are watching, and we want you to bless them. But before you do that, you are a prophet, a tested prophet, and I have tested your prophetic grace. We want to know, what is God saying for the hour? What should the believer be? How should the believer behave in this season in which we live in? How should the believer behave? How should a pastor behave in this time in which we live in? Because our approach matters. It affects the response of our generation to us. What is your counsel and what is God saying to you in this time in which we live in? How should a believer approach this, sir?
You see, before this pandemic broke out, for 2-3 weeks, I kept preaching about value for God.
Yeah.
In church, I kept preaching about it. I kept telling our church that what will you do that day when no church, you are faced with the world. No pastor, no church, you are now faced with the world. So when it happened, most of them, our members were like, oh my God, did you see it coming? I said, no, I didn't see it coming. I just sensed Christians have become too casual. Every believer, Romans 12, awake from your slumber. Fervency in the spirit, serving the Lord. Awake. Your prayer life, your study life, your walk with God. It's time to be Christians. It's not time to even be pastors. It's time to be Christians.
Christians.
It's time to be believers. It's time to go back to our prayer altar and be believers. It's time to be born again. It's time for us to begin to pursue God with the heart of a child. Like he said in Matthew 18, when they asked who is the greatest in the kingdom, he brought a child and set the child in their midst. You That's can true. Be childlike, but not childish.
That's true.
You can be childlike and not childish. It's time for us That's to have a childlike approach to God. This time has come that when this pandemic is lifted, there should be a rush into the house of God. If you are not a worker, you are rushing to become one. Because what we will now be working on is injury. God told me. He said, what you all have seen is a pre-rapture experience. That's what the Lord told me. It's a pre-rapture experience.
Experience.
So when I give you time, I lift up this pandemic. It's now an opportunity for us to serve God with zest and zeal and so much energy. Our prayer life should be revived. Our passion for God should be revived. Our hunger for heaven should be revived.
It's
a reviver. This season, God told me it's a reviver. We are going to see an explosion like never before. But this time around, let's all return back to the altar, the prayer altar. Value. For the things of God. Uncommon value for the things of God.
Uncommon value. Yes, sir.